When Cream disbanded, fans were shocked. Eric Clapton headed to his rural estate for a rest. Out in the British countryside, he revived a friendship with his neighbour Steve Winwood. Winwood's band Traffic had recently called it quits.
Well, I have immediate plans to do a thing with Stevie for an album, you know. I don't know whose album it's going to be, actually. It might be his and it might be my album, or it might be our album.
Informal sessions, often including Ginger Baker, drifted into the formation of another band. The music was a hybrid of Clapton's blues rock and Winwood's hippie jazz pop. As soon as rumours of a Clapton-Winwood group appeared, rock fans began getting excited. What else could they call such a band but blind faith? The rock star vibe that surrounded the band made it hard to go about the simple business of music making.
I seem to be able to get into the guitar more if I just don't think about, you know, if I just close my eyes and go somewhere else.
Blind Faith's debut in London's Hyde Park didn't live up to expectations, but how could it? The era of media hype was in full swing, and Blind Faith was branded rock's first all-star supergroup. Riots erupted at shows in New York and Phoenix. An even bigger battle broke out over the album's cover, which showed an adolescent girl naked from the waist up. Despite a Grammy nomination for Best Album Cover, the sleeve was banned in America. Clapton became bewildered and disillusioned. In a matter of months, Blind Faith was over. Immediately following the demise of Blind Faith, Clapton joined John Lennon's Plastic Ono Band for a memorable performance at the Toronto Pop Festival. Eric was becoming highly dubious of celebrity. He liked being a sideman. He began taking the advice of a new pal, Delaney Bramlett. Delaney and his wife Bonnie had a tight, funky band that opened several Blind Faith dates. Their music was born in the American South, boogie, gospel and R&B, the kind of stuff Clapton loved. He withdrew from the spotlight and toured as a member of Delaney and Bonnie and Friends.
A brand new record was just recorded with Eric Clapton singing. There's one aside, his new singing still, I don't know who's left. You say you want everything good for me, but I know you so well, I can tell your mind's making me.
Delaney was a big Eric Clapton supporter. He thought Eric should be singing more and encouraged his songwriting too. The result was the guitarist's first solo album. Through influences like The Band, Delaney and Bonnie, and his Delta Blues heroes, Clapton began to carve his own identity. The psychedelic outfits and the electric hairdos of the Cream days were replaced by a comfortable elegance. Clapton began to come off less like a guitar god than a country gentleman. Let it rain, let it rain, let your love rain down on me. When Delaney Bramlett fired his backup band for demanding pay raises, Clapton invited the keyboardist, bassist and drummer to his home in England to be part of his next project. They jammed for months, did some gigs and developed a real group sound. By the time they hit the studio in Miami, they were working under an assumed name, Derek and the Dominoes. Clapton and the Dominoes were invited to work on his friend George Harrison's All Things Must Pass. It was during this time that Eric fell madly in love with George's wife, Patty. The Harrisons' marriage was shaky and Patty was deeply flattered, but Eric's love went unrequited. Layla was Eric's heartfelt plea to Patty, the song in which Clapton proclaimed his eternal love. The performance was one of rock's most mesmerizing, but it wasn't enough to get the girl. Patty Harrison stayed with her husband. Eric took all those feelings of passion and turmoil into the studio and channeled them through the hard-rocking Dominoes. You know, it's just your foolish pride.
There was passion in this album because I was madly in love with this woman that it was all about. And the band was caught up in it, you know, and that's, it was just really a big, big, heavy movement going on.
The sessions themselves were also fueled by an abundant mix of booze, grass and heroin. It wasn't long before the heroin began working its way into Eric's life. Dwayne Allman, the great slide guitarist, was introduced to the group by producer Tom Dowd. He and Clapton formed a mutual admiration society, and their friendly competition nudged Eric into great heights of expression. Layla and other assorted love songs contained the most intense performances of Clapton's career. Back home in England, Eric made plans to visit with Jimi Hendrix. The Dominoes had cut Hendrix's little wing on Layla, and Clapton had bought his pal a guitar. He planned to give it to Hendrix at a Sly Stone concert, but the two didn't connect. The next morning, Clapton found out Jimmy had died during the night. Eric was crushed. Soon after, he learned his grandfather had only a short time to live. Just a while after that, his Dominoes partner, Dwayne Allman, was killed in a motorcycle accident. Derek and the Dominoes went out on the road. Some nights they were great, other nights they were less inspired. During an attempt to write and record a second album, the band collapsed. Another project that Clapton couldn't sustain. His friends were dying, his bands always fell apart, and the woman he loved was unattainable. Eric took his heroin and hid himself away for almost 3 years. Eric called his addiction a journey. He was 26. He hid out in his house watching TV or building model cars. His girlfriend Alice cared for his daily needs, though she fell prey to heroin too. When George Harrison asked Eric to play at a fundraising show for famine and flood victims, Clapton said yes. The concert for Bangladesh was a big deal, the first all-star charity event. While Clapton got through a duet with Harrison on While My Guitar Gently Weeps, he was clearly unhealthy. After Bangladesh, he withdrew again. Days turned into months, and Clapton's friends worried about his absence. Pete Townsend kept trying to break Clapton out of his drug routine. He finally got through. At the start of 1973, Eric Clapton played a concert at the Rainbow Theatre in London.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked specially to announce Eric Clapton and the Palpitations!
Townsend assembled an all-star cast, including Stevie Winwood and Ron Wood, to support him. It was a heartfelt, if not spectacular, gig. After one night of music, it was back to the house, the seclusion, and the heroin. Clapton was not only playing the blues, he was living them.
Dear Lord, give me strength and carry on.
As the situation worsened, Alice's father stepped in. He'd heard about a Scottish doctor, Meg Patterson, who cured addicts with an experimental electroacupuncture process. After a few tough months of therapy, Eric and Alice were doing better. Before long, his mental health rebounded along with his physical health. It was time to head back to the music. In early 1974, Clapton returned to Criteria Studios in Miami. He was joined by former Dominoes bassist Carl Radel, who brought in a group of relatively unknown musicians from Oklahoma. The chemistry was right, and the band recorded songs ranging from the blues of Robert Johnson and Elmore James to laid-back acoustic ballads and funky southern R&B. Guitarist George Terry introduced Clapton to Bob Marley, and Clapton's version of I Shot the Sheriff introduced the pop world to reggae. The album, 461 Ocean Boulevard, ushered in the next phase of Clapton's career. And while it contained no real guitar heroics, it did make a statement. Eric Clapton was back.
Well, hello, old friend.
Hello, old friend.
It's really good to see you once again.
The comeback tour of 1974 saw Clapton headlining arenas. During his long absence, he had become a legend. It was at this moment Clapton again called Patty Harrison. She accepted an invitation to join him on the road. Clapton was thrilled. The bad news was Eric had taken up with his best friend's wife. The good news was he had finally won the woman he loved. The next few years were stable for Eric. He and his band made records in the vein of 461 Ocean Boulevard. Although none were as vital, each had great moments, and he enjoyed a string of hits. Blues. He became closer than ever to Muddy Waters. The great blues man became a mentor, almost a father figure to Clapton.
We love y'all, just don't work on you.
During most of the 70s, the early 70s and the mid 70s, more of a musicologist than a musician. I just was like a sponge absorbing as many different viewpoints as I could, and I got heavily into country music. Lay down, Sally, no need to leave so soon.
I've been trying all night long just to talk to you. Some critics said Clapton's new stuff was lazy. Slow Hand came out in 1978. It was full of Clapton's love for Patty.
It's late in the evening. She's wondering what clothes to wear. She puts on her makeup and brushes her long, long hair. And then she asks me.
Patty was finally his, and in 1979 they married. The tune Wonderful Tonight was a valentine to her. The album also contained several hits memorable for their deep groove, including J.J. Cale's Cocaine. At 33, Clapton was still living the rock and roll lifestyle. Alcohol had become his new drug. It would turn out to be as dangerous to Clapton as heroin had been.